Coming up next, spooky, scary, Halloween-y, something wicked this way. What, Brandon?
Comes.
Welcome to the Bookening, everyone. A very spooky Bookening. I assume we just heard Toccata and Fugue in D major. Or no, not D major. And we're off with Toccata and Fugue in D minor, I assume is what we just heard. I'm sorry if it wasn't a good version. I have to go with public domain stuff. I can't afford to just buy a good version of Toccata and Fugue in major for the Bookening, folks. Maybe one day, maybe if you support our Patreon page, go to patreon.com and support it. But in any case, you gotta love Toccata and Fugue in D major. What I love is the second part after the da-da-da. Everybody loves the da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But the stuff that comes after that, sadly underappreciated part of Toccata and Fugue in D minor. Your thoughts, Jake?
I have no opinion about that.
You don't have any opinion about it? You don't like the...
I just don't, you know, underrated, overrated. Never really occurred to me to think that way about it.
Brennan, your thoughts?
I never really thought of it either, Nathan.
And
you're always one step ahead of us.
Yes, just like Mr. Dark in Something Wicked This Way Comes. Oh, boy. In Something Wicked This Way Comes, the book that we'll be reading today. That's why we heard the creepy music. It's Halloween, and I'm joined by my very spooktacular fiends of mine, as I like to say. My best fiends in the whole wide world. First of all, over there in the corner, we have the pastor who's a master of bleeding. Pastor Jake Menskiller. How you doing there, Jake?
I'm bleeding.
You're bleeding? Master of bleeding?
Master of it.
Maybe you cause others to bleed. Brandon, I think you need to talk a little bit more into the microphone.
He's a master of it.
There we go. All right, and over there, Jake, how you doing? You feeling appropriately spooktacular as we enter into my favorite month, everyone's favorite month, the month of October?
October. Yeah, there's a chill in the air.
Chill in the air. You bobbed for any apples yet, my friend?
No.
Got your Halloween costume?
Walked out under a full moon to the rustle of leaves.
Have you walked out under the full moon to a rustle of leaves?
Yeah, there's leaves rustling around and there's a full moon.
There you go. How'd you feel? Did you feel?
I spooked out.
You felt spooked out by leaves.
Yeah.
Well, you know who else is here? And you'll appreciate this as the pastor who's a master of bleeding.
Who's
Brandon
that?
Chastfiend! Oh, boy. The scholar who's a mauler! A bleeding! There's not really any other reading-related horror puns that I could come up with besides bleeding, I think, so...
Yeah.
But you're the scholar who's a baller of bleeding.
I am, indeed.
Is he a baller or a mauler?
Mauler.
The mauler, yeah.
Is it of books? What? Spooks?
Spooks? Spooks? Spooks? Spooks? The book scholar
reading.
Who's a mauler
bleeding.
Of books. He's the scholar. Okay, we'll do spooks. He's the scholar who's a mauler of spooks.
Doesn't work as well.
Doesn't really work as well.
Do the bleeding.
You're the mauler of bleeding. Here joining you for the spookening. I don't know. I'm sorry, folks. It's hard to come up with Halloween-related puns. You know what? If you come up with a good Halloween-related pun, send them to me on the Twitter. Maybe I'll use them this next year. Or, I don't know. Just Brandon, how do you feel
about Twitter?
About the creepy month of October and Halloween. You like Halloween? You Halloween? Your family celebrate Halloween? You're more of a Reformation Day kind of a guy.
We celebrate Halloween.
You celebrate Halloween.
Yeah.
That's right.
We do.
Sacrifice a goat in your backyard. You...
No, we don't go that far.
You don't sacrifice a goat in your backyard.
We draw the line at goat sacrifice.
You draw the line. We draw the line at goat sacrifice. Yeah, I'm glad to hear that. It's always a sentence that I like to hear a man say. He draws the line at goat sacrifice.
Right.
Do you celebrate Halloween? You get a sheet. You cut some holes in it. You go as a ghost.
That's right. Every year.
Every year.
All by myself.
All by yourself. You just knock on the door.
Yeah.
You know what you could do? You could pretend to be two kids standing on each other's shoulders.
I could.
You'd just be like, hey, mister. And then you could stick an arm out that was kind of up through the top.
Yeah.
What do your kids do while you're going out alone for trick or treating?
They stay home and hide in the closet.
Celebrate the Reformation.
Yeah, celebrate the Reformation.
Celebrate
that's right.
Reformation.
They sing a lot of hymns.
Sing a lot of hymns.
Yeah. Then I come back and I eat my candy while they watch.
I have a little respect. I'm going to go on record here. And maybe we'll even do an episode of Sound of Sanity about this. But I'm going to go on record. I have respect for people that celebrate Reformation Day. I do not have respect for people that celebrate Harvest Day. Super lame Christian, like the most vanilla fake.
Like, I have no idea what you're talking about.
Is that
about.
A thing?
Yeah, it's a thing. Like, you people that don't, like, you guys are obviously good Reformed folks. You appreciate Tulip and John Calvin and all the rest. But for people that don't appreciate such things, they obviously don't celebrate Reformation Day. But obviously, they're Christians, so they can't do Halloween. What they do is something called Harvest Day, where you go trunk or treating, and you have a bunch of people's trunks, and they have candy in them, and you go around.
Huh.
So it's like the vanilla fake Halloween celebration?
It's vanilla fake Halloween celebration.
Do they dress up in costume?
Yeah, you know, there's those pirates and
so they celebrate Halloween.
Basically.
Okay.
But they don't, you know.
Well, I mean, at least you're not calling it Halloween.
Right, you know, yeah. This is the important thing is that you don't call it Halloween. Because anyway, you guys ready to talk about something wicked? This way comes Ray Bradbury's immortal tale of, what does it say on the front of your book there, Brandon? I'm sure it says something.
The Dark Fantastic.
What is this? The something something of the dark?
The incomparable masterwork.
Oh, the incomparable
masterwork. Fantastic.
You cannot compare this thing to nothing. You guys ready to talk about the incomparable masterwork of the Dark Fantastic?
I don't know how we're going to. We can't compare it to anything.
Oh, I forgot to say, I never said. I can't believe it. I'm your humble and obedient ghost, Nathan Albertson. All right, let's talk about something wicked this way comes. You guys ready?
Let's do it.
All right. Yeah. So, how are you guys enjoying this October?
Weather?
Yeah, how are you enjoying this October weather?
That's great, Nathan.
Tell me about it.
Crisp autumn wind.
What's that sound?
Yeehaw!
It's the spooky sound of a...
Oh, yeehaw!
It's the spooky sound of a zombified Texan.
Yeehaw!
The contextual Texan, of course, is the part of the program where Brandon gives us some context, which is what he's about to do. Some context on the great Ray Bradbury's, arguably his greatest novel, Something Wicked, This Way Comes. Take it away. Oh, Brandon, you should probably, because sound effects are something that people enjoy, you should fire your pistols in the air.
There you go.
Wow. They were extra spooky this time. Did you notice that?
Oh, boy.
All right, take it away, Brandon. Some context, please, if you please.
All right. Let's talk about Ray Bradbury.
Ray Bradbury.
So we'll start with his biography. How's that sound?
Well, that sounds like a... what like we do
the
every
typical
context.
Way we do things yes. Here. We have a format.
Yep.
Ray Bradbury. He was born in 1920 and died in 2012.
Born in 1920, died in 2012. That makes him how old, Jake? In 3, 2, 1, go.
92.
Whoa, he was old.
He was old.
I've got up here a story that was recommended to me, Touched with Fire.
Touched with Fire, yes.
By a good friend of ours.
Mm-hmm. One who may well appear on the Bookening very soon.
Yeah, a member of My Soul Among Lions.
Mm-hmm.
Just a little bit of a teaser there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So Ray Bradbury, 92 years old, and then he popped off this mortal coil or
he did. He was born into a middle-class family. His father was a salesman of some sort.
Right.
They moved. He was born in Illinois. I did not write
Killinoy?
Killinoy. Ooh.
I'll stop with the Halloween puns now.
What was the name of the city? Does anybody remember Winkeska or something like that?
Yeah. Wachowski, Wakensi.
Something. But it would become the inspiration, just like Faulkner's hometown and some of these other authors we've seen. It would be the inspiration for his made-up town of Greentown.
For Bradbury's made-up town of Greentown. Yeah, yeah.
Which would be the central town in...
Something Wicked, Dandelion
Something
Wicked Wine, at least
Dandelion
one more.
Wine.
Yeah.
So just some little trivia notes. He was related to a witch.
Well, there you go.
He was related to a lady who was tried, and I don't know if she was killed, but she was tried in the Salem witch trials.
My midwife.
Mary Bradbury.
Was a witch.
What?
Not my midwife. What do you call those ladies that help you be born?
Midwives.
Yeah, but there's another word for them.
Doula?
Yeah. My mom had a doula. They actually canceled her before she done birthed me because it turned out that she was a practicing witch.
Huh.
She used to ride around on a broomstick, or so the story goes.
Well, there you go.
he was born in.
Pretty interesting, huh, Brandon?
Oh, yeah.
He was Adula, born... or as I like to call her, Agula.
I was with you there.
All right, Brandon. I'm sorry. I'll stop interrupting.
I'm going to try
content.
To guess all of your puns. All right. He was born in Illinois. They moved to Phoenix, Arizona for a while, but eventually they ended up in Hollywood, and he grew, he was enamored of it. He would, I think, rollerblade down the road to try and see celebrities.
Did they have rollerblades back in the day?
Surely they weren't that old.
Surely, they, I don't know. He would do something, maybe skateboard.
Skateboard.
Were skateboards that old?
I don't know.
Hoverboard.
Nathan's got the computer.
I think it was hoverboard.
Nathan, why don't you use that Wikipedia and tell us when rollerblades were invented?
It's probably on Wikipedia, yeah. That I saw that anyways.
So we have to have Wikipedia in every episode now, apparently.
What'd you say?
So we have to have Wikipedia in every episode.
Some guy on Twitter was saying, good jobs using Wikipedia.
In every podcast that you...
Oh, that we ask Wikipedia?
Wikipedia.
Wikipedia.
I'm just going to lay down and take a nap. Y'all are done.
Okay.
Wake me up.
Well, yes, we do use Wikipedia, and... It's an easy source.
Wikipedia is a good...
If you're tired of listening to the Bookening and you just want to read a book and know what Brandon would say, you can just go to Wikipedia. Is that what you're trying to say?
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's what I'm trying to say.
Wikipedia.
Not everything I say comes from Wikipedia.
Wikibleedia.
Wikibleedia.
What? I'm just trying to stuff more Halloween puns.
I'm just going to lay down and go to sleep here.
Wicked bleedia.
Oh, there we go. That's much better. Wicked.
All right.
Wicked bleed, yeah. Wicked bleed, die, yeah. It would be the most.
Wicked bleed, die young.
Wicked bleed, die, scream.
Okay, die, Anya.
Die, Anya.
Wicked bleed, die,
Good night.
There you go. I think we've managed to stuff the maximum amount of Halloween puns. We have wicked bleed, die. Anyway,
so he was enamored of Hollywood. We don't know if he rollerbladed or not. I have this guy who knows all about Wikipedia.
Trying to log into the Di-Fi here, and I'm having some trouble.
Okay. He started writing from a young age, spent a lot of time in libraries. In fact, there were the Carnegie libraries. Have you ever seen these before? They're all over the place. The Carnegie Foundation gave money to counties, and they would build these libraries. We actually have them all over Indiana, and they're fairly nice limestone buildings. Anyways, I liked that fact. It said on Wikipedia, I'm going to keep rubbing that in.
Wicked Diapedia.
Wicked
die bleed.
Yeah. Some of his favorite writers, he read a lot of Wells, Verne, Poe. At the age of 17, he got into reading the pulp fiction magazines of the time, which was called Astounding Science Fiction. And he has a quote here from a non-Wikipedia source.
Oh, very nice.
I'll start just noting every time I have a non-Wikipedia source. This is from an interview.
Brennan, I'd like to just interrupt you real quick to say he roller skated.
Oh, that's what I said.
You said rollerbladed.
Oh, rollerbladed.
Rollerblades weren't available until our day, I think.
Okay, so he roller skated.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I meant, probably.
I'm glad we got that sorted out.
I'm glad we got that.
Anyway, you had a quote. I'm sorry to interrupt.
I started reading books in the library when I was 7 years old. I lived in the library until I was 12, and then I fell so in love with books. Finally, I decided to become the writer. I kept going to the library and educating myself. I never went to college and went to the typewriter and wrote every day of my life. For 20 years, I went to the library 2 or 3 times a week. This gave me an education and became the Ray Bradbury that you know. So he actually was pretty down on a typical college education, very up on the kind of education you can just get from going to a library 3 days a week and lots of books. And that's what he did. That was his training. As I said, he read a lot of Wells. He read a lot of Verne. He read a lot of Poe. He also had a fairly broad taste in some of the modern writers. He read Catherine Ann Porter, I think, was one of his favorites. Eudora Welty, some of these Southern writers who were, I guess, more avant-garde, at least more highbrow than people typically give Ray Bradbury credit for. Because as we'll talk about, he's more, I guess he's kind of in between King, Stephen King, the more pulp popular writer,
mm-hmm.
and the more serious writer.
Yeah.
I think he's situated somewhere in between those.
Yeah. I don't know that critics have quite figured out what to do with him because he's... Yeah, well, we'll talk about that more, perhaps. But
yeah, well, he started his career by contributing to what were called fanzine magazines. And these were basically exactly what they sound like.
They were the internet before the internet.
Yeah, I'm trying to think what they call those stories that are based on something else.
Fan fiction.
That's it. I don't know why that was so hard for me to remember. But he wrote basically fanfic for a while until finally at 22, he did sell his first story. 24, he became a full-time writer and published Dark Carnival, which was a series of short stories.
Published, if I may, through Arkham House, which was a small imprint developed by August Derleth, who was the, He was the, a guy that comes after a guy, and he comes after a great guy. Not a successor, but like there's a guy, like John Calvin wrote a bunch of great stuff, but then a guy came after John Calvin and he kind of synthesized a lot of it and did his own take on it, and a lot of people know.
Chariton? Better example is more like Luther and Melanchthon, probably.
That's what I was actually thinking of, is Melanchthon. What would you call Melanchthon?
Protégé?
Yeah, but it's like Melanchthon's not important except for insofar as he helped to spread
Luther. So Luther exists and he's a big blunderbuss and he's fighting on all kinds of fronts, and Melanchthon comes along and he sort of synthesizes and tries to produce some kind of systematic
proselyte.
Yeah, I don't know what the word is, but this guy, his name is August Derleth. He took the great H.P. Lovecraft, who everybody agrees is the most influential horror fantasy kind of a dark fiction writer of the 20th century. He took H.P. Lovecraft's work and he synthesized it and made a mythos out of it and created a small publishing imprint to publish it, and really kept Lovecraft alive and is responsible for a lot of Lovecraft's enduring legacy. But he also published Ray Bradbury's first collection of short stories called Dark Carnival, which is a wonderful collection of stories, no longer really available because it was just a small print run. But later, Bradbury would revise it, kind of take out some of the tackier horror stuff, make it a little bit more classy, and release it as The October Country, which, fun fact, is my favorite collection of Ray Bradbury short stories. So you can still read most of the best stories from Dark Carnival in The October Country, but you can't read Dark Carnival because it's no longer in print, unless you can find it for $500 on eBay or something like that.
Wow. Sounds like you should be doing this.
I think we have a true fan over here.
I think we got a fanboy.
I'm going to be a true fan. I'll talk about that more later, but go on.
And we're not to baggage check yet, are we?
Yeah, we're not to baggage check yet.
Dark Carnival. The one and only Truman Capote was responsible for him basically hitting it big. He pulled out one of his stories, Homecoming, from what was called the slush pile at the time. So this was a period of history where you had these, you had this one journal here. What was it called? The Astounding Science Fiction, but you also had the rise of stuff like the New Yorker, and you had the rise of the Atlantic, these other journals, the Sewanee Review, where people would send short stories and you would get published and they would make you famous.
They were the brokers of fame.
Yeah,
and
so, the Southern Review, the Sewanee Journal, those they're the ones who made Flannery O'Connor famous. The New Yorker made guys like John Updike famous, and then you had, in the realm of science fiction, you had stuff like this, Astounding Science Fiction. Mm-hmm. You would send your stuff. You would hope that they would pick it up and publish it, but often your stuff would just get thrown into another big pile, and this is apparently still how it works. It's just more like a spam filter.
Right.
So if you send something to the New Yorker, if you've ever done anything like that.
Right, I send pieces to the New Yorker all the time.
Yeah, most likely they'll print it off and they'll put it in what's called the slush pile. If they're ever running low on stories, they'll send some lowly person, or occasionally a Truman Capote, I guess, will go and they'll dig through it and maybe they'll find something. He found Homecoming, published it, and it won the O. Henry Award in 1947.
There you go.
I found this interesting because in Something Wicked This Way Comes, there's that whole portion on coincidence where actually Mr. Dark, where he's referencing Charles Dickens.
Right.
And says that you boys like Charles Dickens. He was all about coincidence. So it seems like, and you see this often with authors in their early stages, but especially I think with Bradbury, that it's a lot of coincidence happens to get him to where he was. I read that he ran into Isherwood, Christopher Isherwood, who wrote the Berlin stories.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever seen the movie Cabaret, which you probably shouldn't have seen it, but if you saw the movie Cabaret, that's based on the Berlin stories.
Yeah, he ran into him and he put, I think, the Martian Chronicles in his hand, and that's responsible for giving a really good review. Truman Capote happened to see his story on the top of a slush pile. One of the universities, it might have been, where was he? It might have been UCLA.
I'm not sure.
Had typewriters for rent for fairly cheap, so he was able to go and use those, and for like $9.80, write his first book that would become Fahrenheit 451, which was what would make his career, was this book Fahrenheit 451, which, you know, I think in this room we have mixed feelings about that book.
But do we have mixed feelings? Does anyone like Fahrenheit 451? Have we all read Fahrenheit 451? Do you like it, Jake?
Well, I remember. Define read. Back when I was first married and training for ministry, I was also working as a commercial painter in Indianapolis. I would read or listen to audiobooks. I don't remember what version this was, but I listened to Fahrenheit 451 and I was not a huge fan.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan either. I remember it being one of those books that you kind of had to read in high school that you kind of always saw in the school library and that you just kind of resented for that reason. Like it was one of those everybody has to read it books, and I just, not a good one. Not one that rose above being an everyone has to read it, but being, it was kind of a little bit obnoxious and overwritten.
It struck me as, yeah, very overwritten.
Lots of weird
cheesy
metaphors.
And I wanted to give it more credit and say, well, maybe the reader was just reading it stupidly, but
the reader on your audiobook, yeah,
because you know the reader on your audiobook, especially if you've ever used LibriVox, can really color and spoil a great book for you.
Maybe like having Forrest Gump read it to you or something.
Right. So I actually think this came from probably the public library, because I think Amanda was just sort of going and picking out books for me from the public library.
Oh,
so I would have,
that might be interesting.
Yeah. It probably had a list of like classic books that I either skipped in high school or just had never read or whatever.
Right.
But yeah, I wasn't impressed by it. And I know that our listeners that are huge Ray Bradbury fans who think Fahrenheit 451 is the best book ever, one of their favorite books. And I don't know what to say to you, except I'm sorry. It's just, I thought it was really cheesy and overwrought.
Maybe we'll talk about this more during Baggage. What's that?
The Mechanical Hound.
The Mechanical Hound. And there's this whole scene where his wife is hooked up to like machines because she's OD'd. And it's like, the snakes were running up her arm. I mean, it's like, there's a lot of that kind of stuff in Something Wicked. But
really, well, we have to talk about, too, I mean, we'll talk about this in talking about this book. It's sort of one of those prototypical dystopian type things that, you know, lots of people have imitated since, and I don't know what exactly came before it, but Something Wicked This Way Comes is a book that there are millions of imitations but I think we're all probably going to agree that it sure holds up and stands the test of time. But you want to give something like Fahrenheit 451 that was innovative or new the credit of at least inspiring things that ended up being better.
Yeah, I don't want to make any definitive statements about the book because it's been too long since I've read it. It might be great. I just
This would have been probably 10 to 15 years ago for me since I've read it, and a lot of water under the bridge since then. So
yeah, right. We'll have to revisit it.
Right. Yeah, maybe so. I think we should call it Scarenheit 451.
Ooh.
Didn't predict that, did you?
No, I guess so.
Always one
step ahead,
death ahead.
Nah, there's still some great ideas in that
yeah,
book.
There is
the
one
whole ending
scene
of the book is
the
beautiful.
Ending is, I think, a really creative,
that's what I was about,
clever idea
where
yeah.
everybody has memorized
yeah that's
books.
Right,
they become
awesome.
A carrier for that book. That's a great idea.
There's also, Bradbury always has these great images, and if Something Wicked is full of them. I'm just gonna call it Something Wicked, sounds a little pretentious somehow, but I don't feel
wicked.
Like Something Wicked
that. Something
Something Wicked, Something Wicked This Way Comes.
SWTWC.
There's the scene.
SWTWC.
We like our acronyms here.
Mr. Fahrenheit's wife has been watching her TV the whole time, and the whole thing, it's like, you know, she's obsessed with the image and she's watching the TV and all this kind of stuff. And her building gets blown up by terror. I don't remember exactly what happens, but she dies. And there's this wonderful image. I can just imagine it. I still remember it from Fahrenheit 451, where, you know, she's this completely soulless woman that just like spends all her time basically watching images, watching TV. You know, it's a satire of obviously what Bradbury saw, where Bradbury saw the world was heading at the time. And I just remember this really powerful moment right before she dies, where her building basically gets blown up, I think, and the power goes out. And there's just this split second before the rubble comes down on her, before she dies, where suddenly the power goes out and she sees her own reflection. She's reflected in,
that's right,
the TV dies, and suddenly there's no more images, and she just sees herself. She sees her own emptiness. She sees the hollowness in her eyes, and then suddenly all this rubble comes raining down on her. And it's a beautiful, I mean, only Ray Bradbury if Ray Bradbury was ever sucked, which I would argue he probably did, it was only because he was always swinging for the fences. And sometimes he just hit it out of the park. And that one's always stuck with me. Anyway, I'm sorry we've interrupted your context.
This is great.
But
okay, so we've talked about coincidence.
Right.
It's kind of hard as I was trying to think of what category to put his novel into. He's known for, he writes a lot of science fiction.
Mm-hmm.
But he himself said he wasn't really a science fiction writer. Where is that quote? Yeah, to this day, you are described as a science fiction writer by many. Why did you hate this label? Why did you write so many science fiction stories in the 50s? Well, the term science fiction is inaccurate. I am not a science fiction writer. I am a fantasy writer. But that label got put on me and stuck. So he saw himself as a fantasy writer. He didn't see himself as a science fiction writer, which is interesting, because I do think he was a science fiction writer as well.
Well, what he would say, I think, is that he was never interested in the hardware. Yeah. I think that's the distinction he would make, is that he didn't care about how the spaceship got there. He didn't care about how anything worked. He's much more of a Star Wars guy probably than a Star Trek guy. If you had, that's probably the easiest way for us to understand it, is he's much more interested in the story that's being told and the themes that are being explored than he is in any of the minutiae of what you might think about science fiction as doing, you know, of real speculative fiction that's about like, what would happen if Matt Damon went to Mars and then he had to survive there? And there's a certain school of hard sci-fi that people, some people would say that's true sci-fi. Maybe Bradbury would say that's by that standard. Bradbury, he was writing morality tales. He was writing fantastical fiction. Mars was just a weird place where crazy, creepy things could happen. It wasn't, you know, he didn't care what the real Mars was like. So maybe that's, I mean, by his definition, C.S. Lewis, That Hideous Strength would be more of a fantasist. A lot of stuff that we call sci-fi would be fantasist, but I could see the argument for his definition.
I see it. Yeah. It's just interesting to see that he did not see himself as a science fiction writer.
Right.
And that it's difficult to put his work into a category. I know the broad umbrella term for it is speculative fiction.
Right.
Which contains a lot of different things. It's just narratives that deal with speculation about things that could be. So right. Fantasy falls into that. Science fiction falls into that. And whether he's one or the other, I guess, is up for debate. He did not see himself as a science fiction writer.
Right. It's a handy place to put his books in the bookstore. I mean, I think that's about, who cares what the label is, really, but...
Just a few last details about him. He was raised a Baptist, but he did not see himself as a Christian, though he did see himself as religious. So I think he made some sort of point in an interview that I saw that his career wouldn't have gotten where it was had it not been for the hand of something he couldn't understand or see. So that was his stance towards God. But he was also, as far as writers go, fairly decent man. He was married to one woman for his entire life until she died, and they had four daughters together. And from what I understand, they had a fairly happy home life. So.
It's like one of our only writers that feels like every other episode you're telling us about lurid affairs and stuff like that. But
no adultery, as far as we know. I mean,
it's always nice to hear.
Yeah. So, any things you guys wanted to add about him?
The only thing I would emphasize in what you just said is I think it is interesting that he grew up in Hollywood. I think it's interesting that he said King Kong was one of his favorite movies. He loved big, splashy sci-fi. He loved Ray Harryhausen, which, if you don't know who he is, he's the guy that did all those claymation movies like Sinbad and what's the famous one? Jason and the Argonauts, whether the skeletons are fighting the guy, all that stuff. I'm sure you guys have seen some of it. Mm-hmm. But he loved that kind of stuff. He's a very, and I think you can make a good argument that he's a very cinematic writer. You know, I mean, he's a very writerly writer, and that he likes metaphors. He likes to pour on the style, but he also likes a good image. And you can definitely see the influence of Hollywood in his work. You know, he's also a very referential writer. He's always full of references to things and stuff. Something Wicked is chock full of books and things that he enjoyed and pamphlets and everything else that he obviously liked. So he's in some sense, perhaps, this is going to sound pretentious, but maybe he's something of a postmodern in that he's drinking in all this stuff and then he's regurgitating it, putting it through his own filter and kind of spitting it back out and in a different form. He's definitely making use of, you know, I mean, there's works of his that make specific reference to Edgar Allan Poe. The stuff that he likes tends to shine through very, very vividly in his works.
There are allegorical references throughout this.
Yeah, absolutely.
The one that I noticed the most, I guess we'll talk about it, but he keeps referencing peaches.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a nod to Augustine, right? When he stole the peaches. So you keep talking about peach trees and going and stealing people's peaches and how it's always tied to temptation and
right.
stuff.
Right. And Ray Bradbury, I don't know whether that was an Augustine nod or all, but
I imagine it has to be. I mean, that's a famous.
I wouldn't be surprised. Ray Bradbury is definitely the kind of guy that would be like, oh, Augustine, peaches. Yeah, I'll steal that.
Well, that's a good segue into just a brief discussion of the history of the book here.
Mm-hmm.
It started as it was inspired by Gene. He was good friends with Gene Kelly. And in fact, everyone knows who Gene Kelly was. He's the guy who dances in.
He's the protagonist of Singing in the Rain, his famous dancer.
Which he's, actually, I've got here. What kind of movies do you like to watch?
Fred or Gene? What? Nathan? Fred or Gene?
Fred, totally, all the way. Hate Gene. Love Fred.
You hate Gene?
Yeah.
I like Gene.
Better than Fred?
Yeah, probably. I don't know many Fred.
Or as I like to call him, Dead.
To be fair, I don't know if I have ever seen a Fred Astaire movie.
Well, if you did, then you'd be like, why have I been wasting my life with Singing in the Pain?
Because I've seen Singing in the Rain, and I've seen his other White Christmas or whatever that is. Is that Gene Kelly?
No, that's nobody. That's Bing Crosby and Danny Kaye.
No, never mind then. I don't know musicals. Sorry.
Blight Christmas.
Yeah.
To my wife's shame, I don't know musicals.
To your knife's shame.
My knife's shame. That's, I thought you were going to say something. So here's an interview. What kind of movies do you like to watch? All kinds. A lot of Hitchcock movies. I saw Rebecca the other night, a Hitchcock movie. Terrific. I was watching Singing in the Rain with Gene Kelly, a science fiction musical which came out 50 years ago. So I love all kinds. He saw Singing in the Rain as a science fiction because it showed, I think, the beginning is in silent movies, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the whole tension is the move to talkies.
Right.
Isn't
it? Yeah. It's a new technology coming and taking over.
Yeah, so that was a fun little aside. But this was inspired by Gene Kelly. He and his wife became very good friends with Gene Kelly. And he tried to get the early prototype for what would become Something Wicked This Way Comes made into a movie, and Gene Kelly was actually going to direct it. And he took the screenplay, and this is all as told in the afterword to our book here.
Right.
So if you have this edition, which I think most of you probably do, I think it's the one.
Unless you paid like three or four times as much for it. Unless you paid three or four times as much for it or found it at an old bookshop.
That's right. So you've got a...
Or had it on hand from...
Through the Avon books. Is that what that is?
Yeah.
Avon.
He's got a brief afterword where he tells Harper. This story. It's a cool story. You can go and read it. Gene Kelly tried to shop the screenplay around a bit, didn't get anybody to take it. And so Bradbury took that screenplay and made it into, after a few years of working the style and the text a bit to make it the dense weirdness that it is. he turned it into Something Wicked This Way Comes.
Mm-hmm.
So it was published in 1962, right around the time we were having like you said, the birth of this postmodern movement. Puts him in an interesting position in relation to it, because he's also in the tradition of kind of Isaac Asimov and these other guys who were the science fiction writers at the time. But I had never really thought of him. I guess I should have. I hadn't thought of him in context of the postmoderns that were coming around at the time. So Samuel Beckett was writing at the time. Mm-hmm. He would have kind of been in the middle of his career. I'm not sure that he had much of an influence, but O'Connor had just died.
Right.
So a lot of these writers that were seeing success and seeing their careers take off in a similar manner to his, but we can get there in just a minute. The book, as we said, it's heavily allegorical, and also just another interesting point is we mentioned that we thought it might, and in fact it did, have an influence on Stephen King. This is one of his favorite books, and I think he describes it as a direct direct influence on it.
Yes.
Which you can see that.
Not surprising.
For sure.
Yeah. Not at all.
I mean, I think you can see that there. You can see it in things like Stranger Things, the new phenomenon that's out right now.
Oh, sure.
Which is just a ripoff of Stephen King and Steven Spielberg.
Well, Stephen King wrote dozens of novels about ancient evil invading small towns, which Something Wicked This Way Comes is one of the quintessential best of those kinds of novels. So.
Yeah, but it's what every good book does. It takes a setting that you're familiar with. In America at the time, it was this new small town suburbia that was coming into existence, and you take it and you present this old evil that comes into it, and it's fantastic. It's a good formula, and it works here for sure. I think we briefly mentioned this, but this book is set in Greentown, which is based on the town he grew up in. Dandelion Wine is seen as a direct predecessor to it. This is the autumnal setting, and Dandelion Wine is spring. Even though he did not see himself as a science fiction writer, I think it is interesting to position him within the history of science fiction.
Oh, sure. It's obviously in that history.
Yeah. Like the detective novel, science fiction has its roots in earlier mishmash of traditions.
Right.
And then eventually it has these kind of central figures who found it. And they are, you look back to them as the fathers of this genre. And so we saw that with detective novels. You had here and there bits and pieces of it coming until finally you had Conan Doyle, who kind of put the stamp on it, and this now was a genre. And so with science fiction, you had all these different sorts of roots. You had fantasy, fable, medieval romance, all these things. So you had Chaucer, some of the medieval romance. You had theories of planets and stars and all this weirdness, the melancholy theories of the Middle Ages, all these things that would get wrapped up into poetry and into fables and into stories that were just weird and had to deal with either the otherworldly or they had to deal with machinery. So you see some of this in things like Mort d'Arthur.
Right.
Especially with the Grail stories.
Right.
Chaucer has a few stories that are a little bit science fiction-y. You see a lot of this with scientists who are trying to propound their theories of
attempting to propound
their theories of the spheres and how the spheres
their theories.
Their theories, ooh, of the spheres.
Their theories of the fears.
Yep.
And these other metaphysical theories of the stars and the planets rotating around one another.
Metaphysical.
Yeah. And you also see some of these weird scientific fantasies and flights of fancy and reason, even in works of men such as Leonardo da Vinci.
Sure, yeah. Absolutely.
Where a lot of his drawings are these weird things that may or may not have ever even been intended to work.
Mm-hmm.
But they definitely were flights of imagination based on science.
Sprites of imagination.
Based on science.
Oh, boy, this is...
you can't beat them, join them. That's...
yeah, that's right.
If you can't bleed them.
So we have Leonardo da Vinci. He's right in the middle of the Renaissance and leading into what we call the Enlightenment or the Age of Reason.
Yeah, we learned about this in the Agatha Christie. Nobody could even read books or...
yeah, that's right. So people learned how to read. That was one of the very first things that happened.
And then human reason took off around, I think, like the 1500s, 1600s.
Yeah. And so with that came an interest in science, but in science as we think of now, where it's very mechanical, very theory-based, very observation-based. And so you had even astronomers like, I had no idea. Thanks to Wikipedia, now I know. I'm going to keep rubbing that in.
Wicked.
Wicked. Diebledia.
Yes.
Johannes Kepler.
It gets better, funnier every time.
Oh, yeah. Johannes Kepler, he wrote a book called Somnium.
There we go.
Where a boy and his mother learn of an imaginary island based on the moon from a demon.
There you go.
So, and a lot of people look back on that as this... the founding document of science fiction.
Mm-hmm.
It was actually fiction based, but it was science. It was meant to teach you about science. And so some of the other books that you would have that would qualify, The Tempest apparently qualifies.
There you go.
Utopia by Thomas More qualifies. Gulliver's Travels qualifies. I would argue it would.
Oh, sure. There's Floating Islands.
You have
and
the Floating Islands and the whole, yeah.
Talking horses.
That is the weirdest part. I always forget about the Yahoos.
Very strange part. Then once we get past the Lilliputians or whatever they're called, that
I
book
always,
is
whenever
really
I,
weird.
I always feel like I've smoked something when I read that book, because that is a weird book.
Exactly. And how many times have you read that book?
A few times. Yeah. And
a few books.
A few books, yeah. I read it a few times, and let me tell you, it's not a book for young people to read.
Not at all.
It is it's a dirty book.
The Halloween version, by the way, Scullivers.
Scullivers. Gravels.
I love it.
Okay. So what you see with science fiction is what would become science fiction. It's now taking on this... First, it deals with the strange and the weird. It also has kind of political undertones, or at least moral undertones. And you see a lot of this with what will become dystopian fiction later on, especially. So, dystopian.
Dystopian. I'm going to literally lay down in the middle of the floor and go to sleep.
But it was also in its early stages, so it was closely also linked with fantasy, which... slowly see the argument I'm building is that they're all kind of the same thing.
Mm.
It's also closely linked with another form that was growing at the time. Can you guess? It's October.
Horror.
Yeah. It was also closely linked with horror. And so one of the earliest novels that we have that people point to as both one of the early founding science fiction texts and one of the early founding horror texts is Frankenstein.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of is both, right? It's both science fiction and it's horror. And so from its earliest stages, science fiction has always been kind of a melting pot.
Sure.
Closely linked with fantasy, closely linked with horror. And we get actually what we know as modern science fiction, where it has its particular cast of things that happen and is actually not quite what Ray Bradbury is doing. We get those with Jules Verne and H.G. Wells, who are both mid-19th century writers. You know, they were dealing with... H.G. Wells was very... concerned with politics. Verne was very concerned with just sort of the imagination and the actual technology in the book that was happening. But that's where we start to get stories that deal with either outer space or they deal with some sort of machinery that allows you to explore the world, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of science. That's its own little category of science fiction, which I think when people think of science fiction and what Ray Bradbury was probably thinking when he said he wasn't a science fiction writer, that's kind of what we think of as
science Star
fiction.
Trek. Kind
yeah,
of
Star
that,
Trek.
Yeah.
Exactly. And that's, I mean, so like we've talked about briefly, that you had in the 20s the onset of this pulp magazine tradition. And actually, it's not that, come to think of it, it's not actually that, it's not like in the 20s this is just something that started happening. Dickens had novels. I mean, Dickens had monthly, quarterly publications where he would publish his stories. And so it was just a phenomenon of cheap, easy printing, that you would have these cheap pamphlets and stuff where people would publish their stories and they would be easily accessible so that people could go and buy these things and authors could widely publish either their fanzines, like you see here in Bloomington. We've got, what's that stupid bookstore? Boxcar Books.
Mm.
I'm sure we don't have any Boxcar Books fans, but if you do, then... whatever.
Sorry, Boxcar Books fans, yeah.
Stop going to Boxcar Books, because you just go in there and it's pathetic, because you have these people who have published their little Marxist pamphlets like they're going to change the world. And maybe one of them will be found by Truman Capote on a slush pile.
Sure.
Eventually, but odds are you're not. It's like everybody who tries to write, you know, a blog or something. But Ray Bradbury wrote for these new pulp magazines that were coming out. And I guess what was new about them was that they were dedicated to these sort of science fiction.
Yeah, writers. Or even to just do a, there were a lot of, I think, since the 1800s, we've had pulp magazines in the sense of magazines printed on cheap, pulpy paper. And Dickens would have certainly written. Dickens had his own. I forget what it was called. What was Dickens' personal? He had his own personal magazine that he published
several.
His own stuff and yeah. Wilkie Collins and stuff in. But what begins to happen when we say pulp, and when you think about a movie like Pulp Fiction, which is based on old pulp stories, what people usually mean is the stuff that kind of came out in between the two world wars from about 1920 to in about 1940, yeah. With some spillover in both directions. But that's going to be stuff like Astounding Tales magazine, Weird Tales magazine,
Astounding Science Fiction,
Astounding Science Detective magazine. And these were magazines dedicated to specific genres, generally marketed to men. They're about 120 pages or so of fast moving, action packed stories. Usually the cover would have some damsel in distress tied up with their clothes falling off, kind of stuff.
Real, some big muscular guy.
Some big muscular guy wrestling an alligator, or, yeah, you know, some cultist about to sacrifice again a beautiful lady. And they like their beautiful ladies in stages of undress, because I guess then as now that sold magazines. But that's what we kind of think of when we think of pulp.
But well, one of the magazines, though, in 1937, Astounding Science Fiction,
mm-hmm,
because of its editor, John Campbell, kind of started to get some respectability. And so they were the ones that were, this was the one that was publishing early works by guys like Isaac Asimov, Arthur C. Clarke, Robert Heinlein.
Mm-hmm.
And these guys are ones that Bradbury would be reading, sure, and admiring and trying to be. And so you had this birth of it kind of in the 20s, where it became the sort of cheesy stuff that would now we're very nostalgic for. And you get some good stuff out of that, like The Iron Giant.
Sure.
Which is a good movie.
Yeah.
So, fantastic movie.
Well, I mean, Spielberg and Lucas and all those guys have made careers out of repurposing that stuff, modernizing it a little bit, contemporizing it.
And making it good.
And making it good, yeah. Adding, like, hire some good screenwriters, hire some good actors to bring this pulp material to life.
Just as a cultural moment here for us, I mean, it's because of these pulp stories and the wide availability, and they're particularly targeting these sort of childish attributes of men, that you get the birth of comic books.
Oh, sure. Ray Bradbury actually wrote for the comic books. He wrote for Tales from the Crypt magazine, Vault of Horror, all those old, matter of fact.
And like we say, I mean, people are now repurposing comic books into really good movies as well. So.
Just for fun, this won't translate over podcast, but maybe I'll include some pictures or something. Folks, I've got a copy of The Vault of Horror, an anthology of the old comics, and here we go. Mr. Ray Bradbury has his own little bio in there. He was very, this is actually what would have been appeared. Like, this is just a compilation of comics from the 1950s that Ray Bradbury wrote for. He says, this is an entirely new experience for me, and I can't tell you enough how much I appreciate the painstaking detail and thought you are putting into your efforts. It seems to me that again and again you achieve the exactly right atmosphere and angle in carrying out the story. Well, I don't know. That's probably not interesting for our listeners at all, but if you, like me, had a copy of, what is this, The Vault of Horror, issues number 32 through 40 or something like that, you'd see that there were many Ray Bradbury stories printed in there.
Guy with an axe in his head on the front.
There is also a guy with an axe in his head on the front. They liked their lurid illustrations then as now. There you go, Jake, guy with axe in head. Lots of wonderful pictures in this.
Not how I would have done it.
Not how you would have done it? Well, you would have done it very silent.
Would have been very silent.
this guy, this yellow guy here does not look like he's being silent at all.
I'm just going to lean right into this one.
Where?
I'm pretty sure that's what Jake looks like, right?
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, wow.
These comics were responsible for the comics code and lots of good comics being banned because parents decided they didn't like that kind of stuff, actually.
They didn't want to see somebody with their head split open.
No, somehow they thought that wasn't too edifying for their kids, but more like scarants.
Well, the last thing I was going to say is just a brief note about his style. I don't know what to say about his style, but I do know that I'll end on this quote right here.
I think it sums it all up.
Well, no, but it does get in something that I think.
Right.
I wrote a long poem a few years ago about taking a journey across England.
This is Ray Bradbury talking now, right?
Not Brandon Chastain.
I'm like, all right, guys, let me tell you all about Ray Bradbury.
I wrote a long poem about Ray, as I like to call him.
Right.
About taking a journey across England to Land's End, and I said to myself, who would I want to take on such a journey late at night and just sit up all night and listen to them and not say a word myself? This first one's interesting. I've had Rudyard Kipling and Aldous Huxley and Edgar Allan Poe and Herman Melville and...
William Shakespeare.
Charles Dickens.
Charles Dickens. Brandon, what score for Brandon? Brandon loves the Dickens.
I do, and I think, and I'll try
to
parse this.
You didn't have to try for that pun.
Well, I think that there's a lot of similarities between Dickens and Bradbury, and I've tried to parse it out, but we can get to that later.
You'll get a chance to make that argument later in the program.
All right, that's all I got.
That's all I... let me see if there was anything else I really wanted to say about... no, I think the pulp magazines are... I'll give you real, super quick history of where I think Bradbury stands within the tradition of weird fiction and speculative fiction, as Brandon was calling it, specifically horror. So you got your Edgar Allan Poe. He's really important, right? You guys ever heard of Edgar Allan Poe?
I have.
Just a little bit.
All right, Edgar Allan Poe, he brings psychological realism.
You're like 3 feet from the mic, man.
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit, yeah. It's important to get after that one. So you got your Edgar Allan Poe. He basically creates the modern horror story. He brings all kinds of psychological realism. But Edgar Allan Poe, he's in the past, man. All his stories are kind of have this vague, even when they're set in Maine, they have this really kind of European-ish flavor. Like, it's just like a scat poem.
Yeah, you keep doing your hands like this. So yeah. I just figured I'd drop a beat for you.
Figured I'd drop a beat for you.
So you got Edgar, you got all the old gothic stuff, Anne Radcliffe, what's the name of the guy that wrote The Monk? You got all these gothic stories that happen in castles and stuff like that with European noblemen that have dark secrets and stuff like that. Then you got your Edgar Allan Poe, and he brings some psychological depth and realism to it. Then you got all these guys in the 20th century, and I think what a lot of them did, I would argue, is they found a way to contemporize it. They realized that the best kind of horror, the horror that was going to strike closest to our hearts, would be homegrown, that it would be much more creepy not to think about the fact that if I ever went to Transylvania, maybe I'd had my blood drinking by some count, but the idea that in the everyday, you know, the stuff, the kind of stuff that Stephen King has made hay with ever since. So I would argue, like with Agatha Christie, you have the Agatha Christie, all her stuff takes place in these weird old mansions, you know, and stuff like that. But then you have the pulp detective stories, which really bring it into the modern city, add modern style violence and modern style dialogue and modern style this and that, and really give it a contemporary flavor that brings it to life, that makes you feel the hard-hittingness of the violence a lot more, that makes it not just feel like a game of suddenly have murder that feels like a murder that you might read about in the newspaper, or that might even happen, that you might be aware of, something that might happen to you. Horror, same thing, in Weird Tales magazine, and a lot, you know, they're still playing with all the same vampires and mummies and all that kind of stuff. A lot of those Weird Tales stories are really silly and terrible in those, in that old pulp magazine, but a lot of them ask the question that I think a lot of good 20th century speculative fiction writers asked, which is what would happen if we brought it into small town American life. And Bradbury is the master of that. And he wrote for The Twilight Zone, which Jake's been enjoying lately, I happen to know. Yeah, I don't know what to say about that. But but if you look at...
Well, the reason I even bothered was because you had told me that he wrote for The Twilight Zone and had some free time the other last couple of nights to... It's on Netflix,
right.
So I've watched a couple episodes.
Well, so if you...
I've heard they're good.
Some of them are.
Yeah, fantastic. The Dylight Zone, as I like to call it.
Boo!
That's a scary ghost. Boo noise.
You always win, Nathan.
Yes. Obviously, all good horror. Like, if you look at an old fairy tale, I think Chesterton, the beloved Chesterton, we find a way to bring him up on every episode. Chesterton, I think, makes the point somewhere that fairy tales were set maybe it was Lewis. It's Lewis, actually, that makes the point that fairy tales aren't fairy tales to people who read them, who read them when they were written. When fairy tales were first composed, they were stories of people who were going about their mundane everyday business, and suddenly a witch came, or a ghost, or a goblin, or somebody, a wizard, to offer them wishes. When we read them now, though, it seems like it's all part of a foreign world. You know, we don't have woodcutters and woodcutters' daughters, and so it just feels all very fairy tale-ish, for lack of a better word. But fairy tales were, in fact, stories of the supernatural invading the mundane, which is, I think, what got lost a little bit with the Gothic tradition, with the Victorian ghost stories and horror stories, which were all pretty elaborate, kind of European, kind of like out there, kind of other, kind of, you couldn't imagine. I mean, Dracula, you could argue, he comes to England, I guess, and then gets defeated by science and good-hearted British, you know, pluck and can-do attitude. But even there, it's like, if you want to avoid Dracula, you just don't go to Transylvania, really. It's the thing to, you know. Whereas guys like Stephen King, most famously, have made great hay out of saying, what would happen if Dracula came to Bloomington, Indiana, where the three of us live? What would happen if, that's what Stranger Things is about, although I've only seen two episodes, I assume that's what Stranger Things is about, is what would happen if some 80s kids that played Dungeons and Dragons and stuff, just like you and me, what if a little supernatural girl with psychic powers came into their lives, and then Lovecraftian monsters, and Spielberg and Lucas, they've made a lot of hay with that kind of thing, but I think that's where Bradbury belongs, along with a lot of the guys like, I would like to be able to name drop it, some of them, but I can't. What is his name? I forget. There's a number of gentlemen that wrote for Twilight Zone and also wrote great pulp stories, some of which have endured, and a lot of their stories are about that kind of thing, about what would happen if some of these gothic tropes came to our fair American shores. And so that's where I think Bradbury belongs. Thanks for listening, everybody.
Good night.
The Bookening Today was written by Nathan Alberson and performed by Nathan Alberson, Brandon Chastfiend, and Jake Mentzkiller. He kills in silence. Yeah, Jake, what kind of fine stuff should our fans be looking out for or doing or stuff these now that they know who wrote this podcast and who performed in it?
Right now, we are in the middle of a Kickstarter campaign for My Soul Among Lions.
That's right.
They're kickstarting Volume 3 in their series of putting all 150 Psalms to music. So go visit and give and support and push us over the edge so we can produce Volume 3 in our Psalter project.
There is something a little spooky about Die Skull Among Lions.
There you go.